Hello everyone, I will talk about how to mock in the 21st century. And the talk is... First I wanted to start with some introduction to special function registers, but somehow one guy today already explained it for me, so I'm really happy because I didn't want to explain it. I just wanted to highlight a bit more about this because special function registers are every time somehow abstracted. You can do this with macros, but often you get a library from the vendor, and this library can help to prevent some fails because macros are not type safe and other things. They are more maintainable because if you can't even detect an error, you have problems to find. You will have problems to find the errors if you don't even see them. And if someone else is reading your code, okay, what is this macro doing? What is this macro doing? To init SPI, SPI is much more readable as a function. And if you have abstractions, unit tests are much more easier to implement. Yeah. A little extension to this, there is another library called Quasia, programmed by Odin Holmes, there in the corner, and it's not a commercial or something like that for it, it's more that I worked with it at my working place, and I know some hidden stuff about it, and I will use it later in the talk, and that's why I will just say that I will use it later, and you know. So the first big part of my talk is about testing and debugging. Normally on bare metal systems, you use, you program your code, you flash your chip, and after it's running, you are testing it. And often you realize, oh, it's not working. What is it? So you change a bit in your code and you repeat everything else, and then 2 minutes can you can work on that 2 minutes without really realizing if it's working or not, and oh, then it's still not working, so you are trying it again and again, and that can be really annoying if you really just change one little part of your code. And testing can be really hell like this. And debugging, yeah, it's every time on the hardware. Unit tests are often not possible. If you try to abstract a protocol or interface. And someone told something, someone said today, just get the code to compile so you can get to the real work debugging. Yeah, everyone knows this, I explained it. It's true, and everyone hates this. But for some cases we have solutions. In this case it's an LED panel, 64 to 32 pixels. And I just wanted to control it. I connected everything. But if you are in a company, you maybe don't have the space to place it somewhere. If it's a bigger display, it gets even harder. Sometimes you don't get it fast enough to test. And if you just want to implement a display program that will display something, you don't even really need the display. You just want something that shows your frame buffer, and then you see what happens. So I tried something and implemented it in a console. Better consoles can have 24-bit colors, so it worked. I could test my code, found enough bugs. I tested something more, and now we have an oblique and unicorn like in every good talk. To program the chips, we have In the most cases, something like a client, that's a PC software. Then a debug adapter, it's a peripheral to modify the target microcontroller. And the target is the target microcontroller. Some clients are debuggers who have already a special connection. Sega have some, it's called Ozone. Other examples are OpenOCD. Debug adapters can be bought and often are already on the dev boards. And yeah, target is the chip that you will use. And somehow I already saw this today. It was the STM and he used OpenOCD. It's not good to read, but it's just the target and the client. And they use JTAG as a connection. The next big part is that Quasia, that I, in Quasia you can combine modifications of the special function registers. You can read them, you can write them, or read, modify, write. And I have all three examples here. That would look like this in the main code for the MCU. If we have something like Cout. But with my bachelor thesis, I found out there is a special theme abstraction in Quasi itself. And through this, we can abstract the read and writes to the special function registers. That means we can run the code already on the computer and not on the target and show what we are doing. And yeah, that was a program. And here is what we get from this. Write literal means read, modify, write. It's using a mask to delete some bits and adding the value to the specific bits. Yeah, so we have a program on the computer who is mocking the hardware. Yeah, and we have the software on as a client on the computer, and we can connect to the MCU with this and modify values on specific addresses. In this case, I used OpenOCD with the default values, and I make a memory write word on the address, and the 3 is the value that I'm writing to this specific address. And at this point, I was some kind of very, very curious because I had some kind of abstraction from the read and writes for the special function registers. And on the other side, I can write through a socket connection to the MCU itself. So I have mocked already the reads and writes. And on the other side, I can really read and write. And somehow I was, no, it's too easy, it can't work. So I had somehow an idea to maybe combine both things to just modify the output of the first program on the PC, that it is usable with OpenOCD itself. And I was a bit lazy, I just used the program and piped it to tenant localhost 4444. And somehow it worked to toggle a pin. But we are scientists, so we must measure everything. I used the vendor library, and it was a bit slower than 2 megahertz. Then I tried Quasi itself on the MCU. We were a bit faster. And then I tried my proof of concept program, and somehow it was only a 0.5 kilohertz. Yeah, first I was so, damn it, it's so slow. I hoped it's much faster, but that's how it is. But what does that really mean for us? The test, also the speed is theoretically good enough for the most test cases, because we often just initialize some controllers or just make some flags and something like that. And this means it can be slower, but it still helps us to debug some problems. And for my benchmarks, I use this specific board. It's an NXP Freedom board with a K64F. And I don't use the external debugger. I just use the onboard debugger, so it's a very slow, cheap processor. If I think, also I never tried it, but if I buy a professional debugger, it should be much more faster. And if we optimize the protocol, it should be even more fast. Yeah. But what does this really mean for us? If we can debug programs through a connection, network connection, on the real hardware. Just maybe someone is working remote somewhere. In the best case, it's somewhere on the beach. In most cases, maybe just a hotel. And you just have to modify your code, but you want to test this code. You don't want to bring all your dev boards with you, and I know some people are doing this. But now you can implement some kind of server at your company or somewhere else. Then you use a debug adapter and connect this to a prototype board that you already developed for a customer or to sell it directly. And in this example, I just thought about the Ethernet connection that can be tested. So you are somewhere else, and you are just pushing your code, and the continuous integration server is checking your code on the real hardware and can check if the data that you get from your prototype board on your computer. Many sensors are just sending today data to some kind of edge computer or other data server to calculate more information out of it. And this test can be automated with real hardware. And that's very powerful, because if you just try to emulate some kind of hardware, there's a chance that you fail at one point or the behavior is not the same. Another example was, what is if you already sold a prototype, or the customer got the prototype, it's already built in a test case. Theoretically, you can be at your work, have a VPN connection to the customer, or a debug adapter. Some even are standalone and have their own Ethernet connection today. And then you can check what's going wrong at your customer. You can be at your workplace. In our case, it would be Bochum. And the prototype could be, I don't know, BMW. And they are saying, oh, something is wrong with your adapter. OK, I would check it. And the code is running in Bochum, but the hardware is modified in Munich. And that's some kind of really a big kind of freedom to debug. And because I was so super, super, super fast, I'm theoretically done. So, do someone have questions? I hope so.
Hi, can you maybe extend a little bit on what you were actually measuring when you showed the frequencies?
I was just toggling a pin. It was, I configured a GPIO pin. So that's the output, and that I have the clock on this pin. And after that, on IM processors, there are toggle registers. And if you write a 1 to it, it toggles. So if it's a high you get a low after that, and if it's already low, you get a high, and that was my test, and I just measured it with the oscilloscope.
I know that the debug interfaces of a lot of chips are at a similar speed as like the front side bus or the bus matrix. Do you have an idea of where the bottleneck might be that you can't achieve like a similar speed as just directly?
I'm not pretty sure where it is, but I think it's the microcontroller that's used as a debugger itself, because he gets many informations from the PC, must evaluate it, check what command is it, and then change it. And I don't know what, how fast they can change the port and the pins, if it's just bit banging or are they really using a SPI bus. And that must be checked. And I think there is on every step some kind of potential. The protocol to the chip, the programming of the chip itself, and the controlling of the pins.
As long as no one else has questions, I'm just going to keep the mic and keep asking stuff. Have you tried writing to bit banding registers through the debug interface? Does that actually work?
Never tried it. That could be interesting.
Do you see the potential to mock at other seams, like at a you know, maybe have the drivers on the chip and mock at some other level?
Yeah, the talk was at the beginning for some kind of helping developers to implement things. In the most cases, the CPU is doing something, and often people know, okay, if I use a DMA, if I use something else, it will be much more faster. But the most people don't even try it because they know, okay, I will have problems, and then I must flash it, and then 2 minutes until I've already get it running. The initialization is sometimes a bit annoying. I had it with some DMA controllers some weeks ago, and if you combine everything of this, the most people think, if it's good enough, it's good enough. So I don't even try to develop it. But with this trick, we can abstract this. So you're just compiling it on your computer, and that's much more faster. And then you see all after some seconds that it's not working or working. And that's a big benefit. And
what about interrupts?
I thought about that, but I still don't have a perfect solution for it. The first part is some kind of vector table. We can generate it, and because we can write to the microcontroller, we can put it in the RAM and modify the pointer to the vector table. That works well. The only problem that I have is if we have them configured, the interrupts want to jump there. And in my tests, I just halted the CPU because I don't want it that some program on the chip is running at the moment. So it looks like I must compile an own RM program for the chip so that I can use this. And that's a bit annoying. I can put it in the RAM, that's not the problem, but to compile two programs for one test is some kind of not user-friendly, in my opinion, now. But it works. Also, it would work, but it's not that user-friendly.
Just automate it. Thanks.
Other questions? Well, thanks, Paul.